Hi, my name is Yetan Partini. I am a human factors specialist and I work with control room solution and control rooms design. So if you are building a new control room or upgrading the current one, please don't hesitate to contact me and I'll help you as much as I can. You have my information on the screen, so just give me a call or send me an email. On today's video, I will be talking about EEMUA publication 201, and it's a guideline that originated in the United Kingdom. You can use this in order to build or upgrade your control room. One thing you should keep in mind is that EEMUA publication 201 is not the same as EEMUA publication 191. This publication is mainly for the control room, or the other one it's for the alarm management. But this publication focuses on the human-computer interface, which I will be showing shortly. Here you can see different industrial fields that you can use EEMUA 201 and the human factors engineering in order to build or upgrade your current control room. And I have been working with all these industrial sectors since all of them do have a control room. And I've been working with other sectors as well that are not mentioned in this one. Back to the guideline itself. Or the standard. The main focus of this guideline or the main focus of this standard is the human-computer interface, or as we call it in human factors engineering or human factors language, human-machine interaction or human-machine interface. But this guideline does have more subjects than only human-computer interface. It does have a workstation. It does have a control room layout, what you should think about it, and the organization as well. I mean the operational task that the operator must perform. Well, if you don't have time and money to invest in ISO 11064, which is another standard, and I have done a video on it, and you want to upgrade your, a small control room, then this guideline or this standard is very good to use it. It does have a control room itself and talks about the control room, I mean the design factors that you have in the control room, abnormal situation handling, communication, control room noise, layout, screens, large screens, and so on and so forth. Another subject that this guideline does include is the operator itself and the role of the operator. Then after, it's a human-computer interface, which is the main purpose of this guideline or this standard. And it, in my point of view, it's better than ISO 11064 since it does have a survey as appendix that you can use. And at the same time, it covers far more information about the human-computer interaction or as we call it, human-machine interface. And of course, in the training, they talk about the competency and simulators. Last but not least, maintenance is part of it, where this standard does raise up the questions what you should think about redundancy, reliability, and system failure if that occurs in abnormal situation in the control room. Let's talk about the control room design factors. You have operator, you have a working environment, you have a console design, you have a safety and facilities. On the operator's part, you have the role of the operator and you have to define who is the primary user and who is the secondary user. On the environment, you're going to find information and recommendation about lighting, heating and ventilation, blast resistance, noise level, furniture, and so on. On the console side, you have the workstation itself and all the related furniture nearby. I mean, you have emergency shutdown panel, storages, comm radios, CCTVs, displays. On safety part, you have the health and safety environment, you have hazards, and of course you have a hazard and HAZOP you can work with, fire prevention, fire control, emergency exit, and so on. And facilities, it's mainly concerned the design layout itself and what you should think about the control room and other facilities nearby, where you, for instance, you have supervisors and you have engineers and you have maintenance people, or you have DCS distributors that need to sit nearby or inside the control room. So, and yes, when it comes to the operator, as I said before, this standard does include the operator's role during the normal operation and during the abnormal operation, what you should think about. And here is the major part of it. It does include the video display units, and then we have the graphics inside the video display unit. One of the main things when it comes to human-computer interface is usability. This standard gives you some recommendation when it comes to usability, and that is efficiency, effectiveness, and satisfaction. And this picture will show you the complexity of the plant and the operator sitting in the control room. So you have an operator that does have a memory, reason, eyes, ears, and hands, and it works in front of video display unit that contains of graphical interface and uses software for automation, calculation, monitoring, alarming, and so on. So you see the complexity. You have the process outside, and you have the operator that works through the computer or video display unit, and it has to make a decision in order to run the process smoothly. This is a very complex thing that you do in the control room, and that's why it is important that you have a proper and well-designed human-computer interface or human-machine interface in order to avoid any hazards or incidents on the plant. Training, it's also part of this guideline, and it does contain a competency and simulator. And in my point of view, it's very good if you are going to upgrade a new control room with a new level of automation. Then it's very good to have a simulator to run different scenarios through the simulator in order to train operators to operate the plant smoothly and increase their level of knowledge for the new automation level that you are going to implement. Maintenance is also an important part of this standard or this guideline, since it has a reliability, redundancy, and system failure. So it does elaborate the problem if you have an abnormal situation in the control room where, let's say, for instance, some monitors doesn't work, and then what is the redundancy and what you should think about it, and system failure as well. So keep in mind, there is more than HMI or human computer interface into the control room, control suite, or control center. Do not start with a control room design, which I've seen many scenarios where you have a beautiful control room's design, but that design is not functional. So it's better to start by identifying function and tasks, workload, workflow, doing risk assessments, checking alarm management, everything from the alarm philosophy, and so on and so forth. And then HMI as well, before you go into the design of the control room. Since when you have all this kind of information, then it's easier to make a proper design of the control room that is a functional and not only beautiful. This was all that I want to show to you today regarding the EEMUA publication 201. It is a light guideline that you can use in case you are thinking to build or upgrade your current control room. And if you think that I can help, or simply you have any question or a feedback, please do not hesitate to contact me. And yes, stay tuned, since from time to time, I will release these kind of videos regarding the control room solution.